I was a teacher when Steve Colgan was in seventh grade. That's how long ago it's been. Pretty old. I think so. Amy Basinger, you were in, or Amy Miller? Older than you. Oh, so I was, when she was in seventh grade. So anyways. He was ornery as snot. Ornery. He still is. All right, what I'm going to ask you to do is ask you to pray yourself and ask God if he would talk to you. Because if you don't want to hear from God, you won't. But if you want to hear from him tonight, you will. All right, so let's pray. Just ask God to speak to you. God, we ask you. We need you. We need to hear from you. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, so John 10:27 says, "My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me." So my sheep hear my voice, and they know, and I know them, and they follow me. Okay, so that's what it's about tonight, is hearing God's voice. So as, when I was in ninth grade, I went to a Baptist camp called Scioto Hills, and I was sitting in the back of chapel, and God spoke to me. And he says, "Man, I want you to be a on-fire, fervent missionary for Jesus Christ, just like that counselor. Just like you think that Steve is goofy and that." I had a counselor that I seen, and she was all fired up about Jesus, and I said, "Man, I want to be like her." And God called me. And so I heard him, and I went back to my bunk, and I wrote a letter to my boyfriend, husband now, and I told him, I said, "I've got to break up with you. Because if I don't break up with you, I probably won't do what God wants, just what I heard." And so then I went home, and I put it in my back pocket, and I met with him, and then blue eyes, man, he had curly hair like Tanner, and I didn't break up with him. And so that led to a long relationship and a long, long walk to where God called me to be. Okay? And so it ended up, and so when you look at me, I want you to think of just some girl that's lived in Perry Township all her life. I'm a grandma. I'm a mom. I got pregnant when I was in high school. Okay? I have no college degree. I'm just an average person, a sinner, saved by grace, okay? So I want you to think of that. And then John 10:27 says, "My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me." So I'm going to show you a video of what I do now in Africa. And so I've been going there for 13 years. I stay for 1 month out of the year. I didn't go COVID year. And so this is what happened to that girl that didn't answer the call of Christ when I was your age, but I never quit listening. I never quit loving God. I never forget what he said when I sat in the back row. And somehow, by the grace of God, I wasn't condemned. He kept using me and using me and using me, okay? So this is what happens when you listen to the shepherd's voice, okay? So I'm just going to talk over these. And so that's where we have crusades, and we buy places like this and let kids live in them and adults. This is a little girl. We go door to door and we give them money and food. And so these kids walk miles with their siblings, and they're in charge of them, and they want to hear the word of God. And those people are getting saved. And over there, you're allowed to dance. Dance is as much of their worship as their voice. And so we just go around the neighborhoods, and we teach, and we put big speakers up, and we tell them about Jesus Christ. And they will stand forever because they are so hungry for the word of God. And so again, look at their faces. They're just there. Look how she's having to hold her sister and hold them. We'll go to different areas. And this is a girls' school, so it's a privilege to be able to go to school. That's Carolyn Hensley, a friend of mine that went with me. We hold soccer tournaments, And so we hold them, and then we present the gospel of Jesus Christ, and the prize is a whole month's salary. We go into the most impoverished, this is where they live. Okay, look at their houses. That guy, I spoke in a prison, and he's so happy because I seen him there. Look how poor he is, and look at the joy in his eyes because he knows Jesus Christ. And we give them maize that they can cook with. That's Benson. He's kind of like my son over there. We've worked together. That's our church that we have now. And again, we just go out and we give Jesus Christ. It's we put up tents. The lady sewed together grain sacks. And a friend of mine supports this little girl, and we built that house for her. That lady is paralyzed from the legs down. This girl, the first year I went, she was convulsing, like white foam coming out of her mouth, and she got saved. We go into women's prisons. We go into men's prisons. It's one of my favorite places to go because it's just neat. And we do a radio broadcast when we're over there, and you'll hear a little bit of, that's the school. We have a school over there that has 240 children. That's their classrooms, and they feel very lucky. Those kids would not be able to get an education without the help of Jesus Christ. There is our land. We bought that entire land. There's the school restrooms, and so don't complain. We built them a house, so Benson and his family has a house to live in. And that's the school over here. This hospital, I don't know if you know Bubba Watson, that's PGA. He gave me $78,000 through TUG, and we built that. Again, every time we speak, we feed them, we give them Bibles. It's very uncommon to have a healthy dog over there because they need the food for people, and they don't have it to give to the dogs. And so this is the hospital which we built. And now we are using it for a school because COVID needed them to be spaced out. So our school meets in this building right now. And kind of a neat ladder there, huh? And so we're just very grateful that we have a clinic in there now, that people come and we have electricity. That isn't a shy thing over there. That's something that they cherish. And so everybody knows it's where the blue roofs are. That's our ministry. And it's clear out. This is a lady that we went out into the wilds. We helped that lady get her goiter taken out. I love the older people there. They have more joy almost than the younger people. That kid had never walked. And so we bought a walker, and he started to put weight on his legs. And so we just do a lot of things. That kind of gave you that's what our ministry is, okay? So it's just me. There's four of us in the ministry. There's me, Jesus Christ, God, and the Holy Spirit, okay? All right, so in 2013, I was working with the Teens for Christ, and I'd worked with them before they were ever cool, okay? But I worked with them, and God told me to quit. So I want you to keep thinking about hearing the voice of God. God wanted me to quit and do something independent with him. And so I heard his voice, and I knew it, and I followed him. That led me to go home for 2 months. Nothing happened. So God told me to quit Teens for Christ. I quit. I went home, and nothing happened. Nothing happened. Nothing happened. And then 2 months later, my mother got brain cancer. And I thought, wow. So for 15 months, it was just me and my mom and Jesus and brain cancer. But remember, God told me to do something independent, and I heard it, and I followed him. Our oldest son during that time created a website for me. And so through that, we developed the name Unreined. So we used to have horses, and you ever feel a horse when he's reined? You don't see his power, do you? But when you unrein a horse and see a horse run with all of its muscles, so what can you do if God would unrein you? If God would unrein your scootering, what would you be able to do? Okay? And so then 13 pastors in Africa scammed me. They said, hey, white lady, why don't you come to Africa and speak, and you can speak to 5,000 people. And I tried to get wise counsel, and I talked to Billy Graham's association. I said, would it be smart for a white lady to go to Africa by herself at the age of 50? And they said, number one, where they're telling you you can go, it can't hold 5,000 people like Cridersville, okay? Number two, it would not be safe, okay? So I went back home in Perry Township in my woods, and I got at my desk, and God says, I'm either God or I'm not. I heard his voice, I listened to it, and I bought my ticket. So I went over there, and I went to that place that they said it couldn't house 5,000 people, and here they come. We were way over 4,500. And then the vice president came in this really bad Hummer, and he parked over there, and I thought, oh man, there ain't no way, everybody's gonna leave. Nobody left, and at that crusade, over 470 people got saved. What if when I heard God's voice, I said, I'm not going? Billy Graham's association said, don't go. But what I'm here to tell you tonight, if God is speaking to you, whatever he's telling you to do, it's going to go crazy because it's going to have the power of the Holy Ghost on it, okay? And something was fishy about that trip. And I went up into those mountains and spoke to people, and they left me there all by themselves. And this fight broke out. And the man I see, it's almost like Vietnam, the guys with the gun and people are running, so I kind of hid in the church. And they said, hey, Mzungu, which is, hey, white lady, we found the guy that stole the phone. What do you want me to do with him? I said, let him go. I want to get off this mountain. So they let him go. And up on that mountain, there was a war before I came. And so they would line the families up on this mountain, and they'd start with the youngest, and they'd cut off the ears, cut off its nose, gouge their eyes, and then they'd kill them. Then they'd go to the next one, the next age, cut off their ears, gouge their eyes, cut off their nose, kill her. Then they go to the next one, and the next one. And the parents would be right here, and they had to watch all their kids die. So when I got there, it'd be like going after a tsunami, and there was no joy in anybody's face. None. None. It'd be like going to the funeral home and saying, there's hope. Jesus Christ loves you. Jesus Christ wants to do, and I remember I said Jehovah Shammah. I spoke on that, and it's about the glory of God resides here. And they're looking at me like, how can he reside here when we just watched our families die? But it's like going into your schools and saying there's hope. There's hope with Jesus Christ. So there is time, another time, I'm just telling you this because I want you to see that when you listen to God, he's going to put you in circumstances that he's going to show himself. So I was in the house of one of the pastors, and the little girl had malaria, and I said, I'm going to walk up to the village after he got home. It's pitch dark, and I'm going to walk up the village and call my husband and have him get people praying. And he says, you can't do that. It's unsafe to walk in the village at night. And I said, I'm going. And so I went. And I could feel, now it's dark and they're all black, and I could just feel the black guys around me, five of them. And I said, Jesu Anakapende, which means Jesus Christ loves you. And they went, whew. Right at that moment, that was my first year there by myself. Right at that moment, I thought, man, my guns are loaded. I am loaded. If God can make five guys leave me alone and not rob me and not whatever beat me up, we can do this. So for 13 years, I've had that confidence in Jesus Christ. So we kept listening, and there was one time where this kid came, and I didn't know it, but I was speaking, and afterwards, here he had put shillings, which is money, in his pocket, enough to buy brew that would kill him. It'd be like drinking gasoline with whatever, okay? Their beer will kill you. You can smell it a quarter of a mile away. So he was going to kill himself. I didn't know it. I just kept speaking God's word, and pretty soon he kept hearing the voice of God, and he came and he came and he came and he got saved. Another time I was speaking in a church and doing what God wanted me to do, and so, this guy sat outside on the road, just sat there and listened to the voice of God, and he got saved. And this has happened. I could keep telling you story after story for 13 years, okay? We kept listening to God, and my creed in the ministry is not to have a plan. Okay, I've taught at Temple, they have a plan. Okay, I've worked with Teens for Christ, they have a plan, and that's all good. But when my ministry's called Unreined, I didn't want a plan. What's your five-year plan? I don't know. What's my five-minute plan? I guess I'm going to Temple and speak on Wednesday night. Okay? Because I want to listen to God, I want him to be an inch in front of me, and I can't see around him, and if he says left, he says right, he says whatever. Whatever he says, I do. Period. Okay? And so 2 Corinthians 1:22 says, "Now it is God who makes both us and you stand firm in Christ. He anointed us, set his seal of ownership on us, and put his spirit in our hearts as a deposit, guaranteeing what is to come." So Jesus Christ, if this is the Holy Spirit, and he puts the Holy Spirit in us, okay, then whatever he tells me is going to have spiritual impact. I listen to the Spirit that is inside me, and I do it. I listen to the Holy Spirit inside me, and I do it every day. Okay, if the Holy Spirit tells me to take Tanner to a spiritual scooter camp, I do it. Anything he tells me to do, okay? We have God as our interpreter, all right? If you want a relationship with God, to see what you can do, so you're going to get older and you're going to say, what does God want me to do? What does God want me to do? And you want to do it so that you are a better whatever, and God wants me to do this so that I can succeed, then you are doing it for yourself. If you hear from God and he wants you to do something and you want to do it for the little people in Africa, for the kid that can't walk, for the lady that's paralyzed, for the kid that's going to kill himself, if you want to serve the Lord for the people, that's what's right. My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. Jesus Christ, picture Jesus Christ in heaven. Did he listen to God? Was it so he could come down to earth and say, watch me, I'm the Savior, I'm the King of Kings, and I can die on the cross, and I can rise again. Did he do that for that reason? No. He did it so you could be saved. He did it so you wouldn't go to hell. He did it because he loved you. Why do we listen to God and go to Alaska or go to Africa? It's not so we can stand up here and say, I'm a missionary to Africa. Because about the fifth time you have to poop in a hole in the ground, the fun and games of being a missionary is over. We only serve Jesus Christ for the people that he calls us to. Jesus Christ came to you, okay? And so what I want you to do now, God just gave me this, as far as asking Tanner, my grandson, to come up and let you see how he listens to God. Because it's one thing to hear a 63-year-old lady say, oh, that's cool, you know, thumbs up emoji or whatever you guys do, all right? But here's somebody that's 15, and I wouldn't ask him to come if I didn't know that he really loved the Lord. I would not ask him to come. Okay, so we're going to watch Tanner in action, and then Tanner will come up and share with you.
The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When the wicked, even mine enemies and my foes, came upon me, they stumbled and fell. Though a host should encamp against me, my heart shall not fear. Though war should rise against me, in this I will be confident. I've got a promise. Turning back is not an option. There's a calling on my life, and I'm not about to drop it. I got this. For this I was chosen. The final word over me was spoken before I was born. I have a purpose that goes far beyond what I want, what I feel, what I see, and what they say cannot be. With God, all things are possible. And when my desire aligns with the divine, I am unstoppable. In this, I will be confident. Of course, the climb is hard. I'm not surprised. The dream is difficult by design to make sure I rely on His might, not mine. His plan, not mine. His hand, not mine. My assignment was conceived in His heart, His mind. And the blessing ahead will always be greater than the battle behind. So this is not the time to compromise or entertain a thousand lies and a million reasons why I can't, or it won't, or it's not, or I'll never. I've heard it before, so shut up, devil. God didn't say He'd make it easy. He said He'd make me better, make me strong, and give me grace to carry on. No matter what the opposition, I only need one weapon. I have the faith to overcome. In this I will be confident. I'm too close to quit, and the stakes are too great for me to hesitate. So whatever it costs, whatever it takes, I keep coming. I show up and take the shot with my hands shaking. The fear is real, but it won't break me. God will not fail me, nor forsake me. I keep coming. I step to the battle like it's already won. Like I got the enemy on the run. I speak and believe like it's already done. In this, I will be confident. He made me a promise. He gave me a calling. I know that He's able to keep me from falling. I focus my hope. My excuses are gone. The moment to prove the power of God has come. He made me a promise. He gave me a calling. I know that He's able to keep me from falling. I focus my hope. The past is gone. The moment to prove the power of God has come. In this, I will be confident. Time is now, the odds are long, the haters are loud, the pressure is on. But devil, you messed with the wrong one. I got my sling, I got my stone, and in the name of my God, I will overcome. In this, I will be confident.
Hi. Thank you. I feel like God's really put this on my heart. And hold on. It's brought me a long way. And I'm just going to get straight to it. I'm going to start with my favorite verse, Matthew 7:24. It says, build your foundation. Wait, I need it. It says, therefore, everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like a wise man who builds his house on the rock. The rain came down and the streams rose and the winds blew and beat against the house, yet it did not fall because it had its foundation on the rock. But everyone who hears these words of mine and does not put them into practice is like a foolish man who builds his house on sand. And what that means to me is it's like put God's words into works. Don't wait. Don't just stand there. And God can do everything for you, but you gotta do stuff on your own too. And that's how you get places. And next step. Here it is. The devil is like a roaring lion looking for people to devour. Devil will take anyone he can get, anybody. But God puts him on a leash. He can only get so far. So, if God can turn two fish and five pieces of bread into 12 extra baskets just laying on the floor to feed 5,000 people, He can do anything. He can. Yeah. You want to come up here? This is my first time. I'm not that good at it.
Okay, so what I wanted you to see is, okay, I've been doing this a long time. And Tanner just cut his teeth on speaking to you. Okay? But what he was willing to do is do it. And like he said, God is going to ask you to do something, and God could do it all. He doesn't need us. But like Tanner said, you've got to put some action into it. This year, if God tells you to speak to somebody at school, speak to them. If God tells you to not do firefighting and do ministry, do it. Whatever God tells you to do, listen for His voice. How do you know His voice? If you called me on my phone, I would think you were some salesman because I don't know your voice. Okay? If Tanner calls me, I know exactly who he is. You have to spend time with God. You have to spend time with Him to hear Him and to know His voice. My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. Okay? So like I said before, I want to follow God this close, right in behind Him, right in behind Him. I can't see around Him. If He goes here, I go here. If He goes here, I go here. One time I was riding a snowmobile with my dad down in Waynesfield, and he told me, he said, Janelle, if I lean to the right, you lean to the right. If I lean to the left, you lean to the left. And back then, you never talked to your parents at all. At all. At all. And so, my dad, we were riding. We were flying hills, flying. And I was holding on to the belt around his back. And all of a sudden, my dad went horizontal. And I went horizontal with no hesitation. We went under a cable that would have decapitated us both. Jesus Christ is the same. Whatever He says to do, you don't hesitate. There are times I have seen Him fall on a scooter. And sometimes I can see a little hesitation, and then but I've seen times where he's up there and I'm like, oh, dude, he's going for it. And there's absolutely no hesitation in his flip, and he lands it. It's when he hesitates in the middle of the flip that'll go a little bit crooked and slide out. And there was a year, I've done Africa for 13 years, and there was one year that I hesitated. And I was more concerned about a girl that went with me and what she thought of Africa, and I followed her advice. And we shut down Africa, shut it down for a whole year. And then all of a sudden, God kept on Africa, 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 Africa. And I could have, you know, all these churches were supporting me, and I could have said, you know what, up? But I said, you know what, I screwed up. I screwed up. I listened to my own voice, and I closed it down. And now I'm going to go right back over. I don't even care what you think. I don't even care. I lost supporters. I'm going back because God told me to go back. Over 5,000 people have gotten saved in 13 years. Stupid white lady, 50 years old, no college degree, kid in at Shawnee school, scooter. The guy that was in that with the white and blue athletic outfit, that is a pro scooter rider, Cody Flom. Google him when you get home. Just think of phlegm, and it's Flom. He's a pro scooter rider that wins world competitions, and he's a Christian, and he spent the night at Tanner's house. What do you think God's doing? What do you think God's doing? What can you do? What can you do for the Lord? What does God want to do with you? I was just like you girls. Just like you. Just like you. God wants to do something. He wants to reach the lost. Do you know that Jesus Christ is coming back? And you guys, I always thought, how cool would it be to be a disciple in the Bible? If I lived in the Bible times, would he write my name down because I loved him so much? Well, guess what? He is letting us be at the end times. He believes that we will listen to his voice and follow him and tell people about Jesus Christ before he comes back. I don't care if it's on a scooter. I don't care if it's on a donkey. I don't care if it's an Allen East, Lima Senior. I don't care where it is. But God is going to speak to you. And you're either going to hear him and follow him and do great things spiritually, not great things for you, great things spiritually. If you say, I can't hear his voice, how I can't hear it, then I'm going to ask you, are you saved? Because the moment you get saved, the moment you get saved, the Holy Spirit is in you. And guess what? You can hear his voice. Let's pray. I believe that there's somebody here right now that doesn't know the Lord as their Savior. And you're sitting there saying, man, I want to do things for the Lord, but I can't because he's not even my Savior. And don't play games with me, okay? Don't play games with God. If you've done it once and meant it, it's done. But if you have never asked Jesus Christ as your Savior, I want you to quietly just lift your hands. One hand. If you have never done it. Nobody's looking around. Your eyes are closed. God, take us back. And so I want you to say this prayer after me. Dear God, I know I'm a sinner. I know that you died on the cross for me. I trust that and nothing else. I believe in you, Jesus. And now I'm saved forever. And now the Holy Spirit is in me. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. and don't lift your head. I believe tonight, the reason why I brought Tanner here is because you guys are such a neat age. What a neat generation. You do crazy things. If there is somebody that you feel, God, I want to hear your voice and I want to obey it and I want to do whatever you tell me to do, I want to do it. I promise you, I will not hesitate. God, I want to obey you. Speak to me. If that's you, raise your hand. I want to hear from you. I want to do things for you. I want to love you with my whole heart, soul, and mind. If you speak to me, I will go anywhere. I thought I was always going to go to Alaska, and it was Africa. But God's going to do something with you. So I'm going to pray over you right now. Just put your hands like you're receiving a gift. Just put it like you're receiving a gift. Dear God, for everybody with their hands held open to you, speak to them, God. We want to hear from you. Speak to us clearly. Tell us what to do and we'll do it. Stand on my head and on Brower Road, I'll do it. I'll do it for the rest of my life. God, I love you. I thank you for dying on the cross to me, and I promise you, I'll obey you. In the name above every name, do something great with these guys. Do something great with the adults. Do something great with the youngest to the oldest. Do something great with Tanner. Do something great with all of us here, God, because we want to tell people about Jesus Christ. And you are going to save them from going to hell through us. In Jesus' name we all said, amen. Thank you.
So, I learned this today. I was watching Stephen Furtick this morning, and sometimes you'll notice, like, the enemy, don't think the enemy can only attack you in one spot, because he can't. Sometimes he'll sneak through the valleys and try and get you that way, but God is just as strong right there. So you can still call on him right there in your weak points. And just like Matthew 7:24, like, to build your foundation on the rock, sometimes the way to find your foundation is you have to hit rock bottom. And so don't be afraid of if you're in a bad spot, because you can still call on God. And just call on him.
Thank you, Janelle and Tanner. That was really great. That's just super challenging to us. You know, what is God telling you to do? What is God telling you to do? Can you hear his voice? If you can't, we challenge you to question, you know, are you saved? Do you put your faith in Jesus? What is God calling you to do? And that's, like Janelle said, that's a huge privilege. God has trusted us as Christians to be on this earth, to preach the gospel, to make his name known. He has trusted us with the future generations of Christians. Are we going to live up to that? Are we going to be faithful to his calling that he's told us to preach the gospel? So what is God calling you to do? Where is he calling you to tell others about Jesus? Maybe it's a friend at school, maybe it's a friend at work. What is God calling you to do today?